Welcome to Bible study tonight at Cross Point Church. We're going to be in Ephesians chapter 4. That's going to be our text for this evening. This is the terminal series dealing with war of the worlds, we have been talking about, and the reason why I call it War of the Worlds, I'm talking about the fight between world philosophies and Christianity, okay? Worldly isms. And so we have gone through different isms. We've gone through positivism, which is basically seeing is believing. We see the culture that we live in exhibits, I don't believe unless I see it and taste it and touch it. We talked about hedonism, where those individuals, we call those people the party people, those people who are seekers of pleasure all the time. We saw in humanism, when we went through humanism, where man is the ultimate authority. And so mankind sees themselves as the center of the universe, the ultimate authority. Again, as I'm talking about this, all of these things fall under secularism, all right? Secularism, which comes from the Greek or the Latin secular, but it just means world, or worldly, okay? It means world. And so we're talking about the ignoring of what is eternal, all right? Or the ignoring of eternal things. So a secular society doesn't believe in God. It doesn't believe in an afterlife. And so all these isms that we have been talking about focus on the flesh, or focus on the person and their pleasure and what they can get. Amen? Last week we dealt with existentialism, where this this thinking of life is meaningless. And so, you know, there's no hope. And so we saw Sartre and Nietzsche and others who have propagated that life is meaningless, that you have people like the Uberman or the Superman, and then the herd mentality, the master mentality and the herd mentality, that there are certain people who attain heights because they realize that life is meaningless and they just go for the gusto and they just don't care. But then you have others who have the herd mentality, in which many times they, not many times, but they put people who believe in religions in, saying that we need something to believe in. and so we saw how the Bible goes against all of this kind of thinking. And so as we go a little bit deeper tonight, in this last series, I want to cover two, and they're almost like brothers and sisters to each other. One is pluralism and the other is relativism, okay? Pluralism and relativism. And as we go through these things, as I've been talking about each week in Bible study, you know, my hope is that we would all notice these things in society. You know, when we're looking at TV and when we're looking at our favorite commercial and it's telling you to go for the high life, and, you know, and you see people doing this and that and putting themselves in ultra danger and saying, you know, coming out the water going, woo, and this thrill ride, and, you know, and then, you know, you pan around the back of them and their family's like this. I just had to, you know, people doing things trying to feel alive. You know, spending money on things that that make no sense. I saw a guy was selling a 24 karat gold bicycle for like $500,000. A 24 karat. Now, if anybody ever had any gold that's 24 karat, you know how soft that is, right? What do you think is gonna happen, you know, when you're doing a wheelie? That's okay. Maybe that's me. Okay, so let's talk about pluralism and relativism. Pluralism is having valid positions. It's having valid positions, but there is no coherence. Okay, so the pluralists, or pluralism is everybody having a position. So you can have Christianity has a position, Islam has a position, Baha'i Faith has a position, Mormons have a position. Everybody have a position, okay? And but there is no unity there. There's no cohesion there, all right? And so one says that's for the pluralists, they say, hey, that's fine, okay? I mean, it's my way or the highway, all right? I don't have to agree with you. I don't care, you know, this is my position. And so if you've ever heard somebody say, that we can agree to disagree, anybody ever said that? We can agree to disagree, all right? But the problem is that works well if I don't know you. It don't work well if I'm married to you. Now, don't say amen. Don't say amen. Just nod and go, Yeah, it don't work real well because we have to find a source of overlap in our positions. Many people fight and fuss about that when you have two people who have two positions that they are not willing to cross or to find a type of connection there, you end up finding two visions developing, okay? And we know that when we have two visions, we have the Latin two, which means division, division. Amen? All right, so we're going to see this as we go on. And again, these are like brothers and sisters. Relativism is saying that each point of view, each position, each purpose, each truth is valid all in itself. Each point of view is good. So if you believe in this over here, that's great. It carries just as much weight over here as something does over there. Okay? So if somebody says, man, I didn't have any money, so I just took the money off the table. I don't know whose it was. I was hungry. I needed to eat something for lunch. Yeah, I can see that. I mean, it makes sense to me. I was hungry. It was some money. Somebody just left it there. Apparently they didn't want it. I took it. Are y'all with me? And another person comes along and says, you know what? Man, a person shouldn't steal. You should never steal under any circumstances. You should never steal. Yeah. Well, you right and I'm right. Anybody ever heard that? We both right. That is a relativistic mindset. Everybody cannot be right. Relativism, pluralism. If everybody's right, nobody's right. Amen? There has to be a standard. There has to be a standard. Has to be one standard. Has to be a root standard which everything springs from. I'm going to show you this. Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 1, and I'm reading down to 6. And it says, therefore, And this is Paul talking to the church at Ephesus. He says, I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you were called, or you have been called. With all humility, gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all. Can you say amen? Paul lays out to the church at Ephesus that there is unity that has to be achieved. The Bible is replete with talking about unity. It talks about how can two walk together unless they be in what? Agreement. When two or more gather together in his name, whatsoever they pray for without doubting, God shall do or accomplish. A three-cord rope is not easily broken. I mean, on and on and on. The fervent prayers of the righteous avail much. It's on and on and on about the unity, about being one body, one faith. Why is that so important? When Jesus comes along, he says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. He's not just saying it because he wants to say it. He's saying it because there has to be unity. There has to be a base. There has to be a foundation. There has to be one truth. There has to be one way. It can't be all these different ways. God's not like that. Let me throw this out here. The earth doesn't work like that. I'm not even talking about the Bible. I'm just going to talk about what they call revelation theology or natural theology. That the world doesn't work like that. The world rotates one way. Can somebody say amen? Amen. It spins one. It doesn't stop and go back, and it goes around. The seasons come and go. Things grow, they're planted, they grow, they die. And it's a cycle. There is a cycle to things. There's order to things. We're not running into Mars, and you know, we haven't sideswiped the moon, and we're not off course. I mean, we've been going the same way for a long time. The same way for a long time. And we're going to keep on going that way because it's order. Order builds things. Chaos breaks things down. When the person who is the relativist says that, well, everybody's point is right and everybody's religion is great and everybody, you can find the way to God in every religion out there. Somebody wrong. Because God is not like that. Why would everything in this world be ordered? And then all of a sudden he's like, okay, open door. Everybody just run on in. I don't care what you do. He is a God of order. And that's what the word says. He's a God of order and not confusion. Watch this. Watch this. So Paul puts forth and he says that we have to be eager in maintaining the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Can I tell you that you don't get peace in chaos? You cannot get peace in chaos. Order facilitates peace. Amen? Watch this. See, here's one thing, and this is very important to understand, how we come up with these type of mindsets. And again, we're talking about, I'm trying to expose what's going on in the world so that we can see it or shed a light on what goes on in the churches. Okay? So in the church, you have people who we're saying that, you know, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. But many times, as believers, people are not living the one way. They're not following the truth. They're not following the truth. I'm not going to look at anybody. All right? So we got a problem with that. Because then the world looks at us and calls us hypocrites. We are to be set apart. We are sanctified. We are separated unto holiness or to be holy. Amen? We are to be lights in this world. We are to reflect the truth and the life, the way. But when we don't, then we act like the world does. Well, if you think it's right, it's right. You feel like doing it, do it. You can't judge. Now, that is in the unbelievers, Cliff Notes or Spark Notes. You know, hey, okay, Christians, how to get them back. Okay, you can't judge me. You're supposed to forgive me. You're supposed to turn the other cheek. If I ask you for money, you're supposed to give it to me. You ain't no Christian, you know. You don't even go to church. You know these things. But the thing is that in their mind, they'll call you on it. Yeah. Watch this. How do people come up with these mindsets? Well, they come up with mindsets because that we grow up in a certain experience. And the experience that we grow up in, be it at home or traveling or whatever the case may be, your work, your job, everything that we encounter lends to our experience. Our experiences shape our perceptions. Okay? The way we see things as valid or as truth. So your experience reinforces what you think, your perception, what you think is valid and true. A person will operate on what they believe is true or valid. Okay? That is called your morals. Amen. That's why people don't have a problem backstabbing you sometimes, because they've been backstabbed. I grew up backstabbing. That's how you get ahead. Where you from, you know? And so they don't have a problem with it. They don't have a problem with, you know, doing this and doing that, because that's how they grew up. It's called our morals or our standard. Okay? I remember years ago, and the first lady loved this. Years ago, and I'll tell a story every now and then, that when we were young, our family was a big family on both sides. And so on the weekend, you know, my father would barbecue, or he'd always, our house was like the center activity. Family would come over, we'd barbecue, OJ's be playing, get on the board, join him. No, y'all? Okay. Yeah. I like the OJ's, all right? He liked the OJ's, all right? So, well, he'd be barbecuing, people come over, and I mean, I love when all our cousins would come over, and we play, we run all around and go crazy, right? Well, when I grew up, you know, and being the first lady, started dating, then we ended up getting married, and so her family on one side is big, and the other side is small, but most of the large family lives out of town. And so for holidays and everything, they would get together nice and quaint, and you know, on the weekends, and they sit down and enjoy one another. And so for Christmas holidays or Thanksgiving, we got all kind of people around, all right? Her family, they're gonna open gifts together and share, and they're gonna go around the room one, and they still do that, one at a time, and open up the gift, and everybody clap. And can I just tear mine open now? That's all I wanna do, you know. My gosh, whoa, how long is this gonna take, you know? Well, when we had our, so what do you think happened on our first Christmas? You know, I got all my friends over, you know, cousins. I'm talking, come on by, you know, to the apartment, man. We're going to barbecue. We're going to have fun. And my wife is like, what is going on? You know, we're supposed to be family. This is family, you know. I got to clean up, you know. No, don't worry about that. They'll help you. I said, she needs some help. Oh, we got it. Don't worry about it. We're going to clean up. You don't even have to worry about it. But that wasn't the point. The point was, her experience was this small, intimate family that we share. And, you know, then once we do out, then we go out and visit people. You know, on my end, it was like, hey, man, let's have a good time. You know, cousins and uncles, aunties, and man, we just going to go visit and run. And this is just totally different. And so we had to learn that. Though I thought my position was valid, and I really thought it was, because that's how I grew up. And she thought hers was valid because that's how she grew up. So right now we're at a pluralistic mindset. Are y'all with me? All right. And once we started talking, then we realized, guess what? That both people had a valid point of view. And so we started moving into relativism. We moving, right? But I found out that we can't coexist like that. So we had to find a referee. Can somebody say amen? And so we had to find something that was not for her or for me. Amen. We had to find something that could show us a way to live this life and could speak about truth. Can anybody tell me what that could be? The Bible. Thank you so much, sister. The Bible. And so, see, the Bible's not on my side, it's not on her side, but it talks about a fundamental truth that we could build on, a foundation that we could build with, that we could find unity with. And see, this is a major problem and this is what Paul was saying, that we got to find this bond. We got to be eager about the bond of unity in the Spirit. We got to get on, but how, we're not going to get along if we don't have the same foundation. Amen? That's why it's so important for believers to be on the same page. We have got to be on the same page. That's why you come to Bible study. That's why you come to church. That's why you read the Bible. That's why we get together and talk and share about life and what we're going through, so we can be on the same page with Christ. Amen. Watch this. So I want to show you a couple things. Let's jump over to Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20. People always say, man, you know, well, what does the Lord want for me? Oh, how he want me to live? But the Bible has standards for outward living. And so, and I'm just going back to the Old Testament, so we can see that it is nothing new. Amen? Thousands of years ago. Exodus chapter 20. What is in Exodus chapter 20? Anybody? The Ten Commandments. Oh, Lord. I got $100 for somebody who can name all the Ten Commandments right now without... Oh, no, y'all looking on the wall. Okay. Oh, man. Oh, yeah. That's okay. That's okay. But he lays out these ten core principles, these commands to live by. And so he says, I'm first. Don't put any other gods before me. Love me with all your heart, mind, and spirit. And then he starts working his way down. Watch this. In verse number 12. And it talks about honoring mother and father. Don't commit murder. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't bear false witness. Don't be lying on people. Get people in trouble. Don't covet. It goes on to talk about, you know, of course I said bearing false witness. Don't kill. You know, keep the Sabbath day holy. You know, that special day for the Lord, on and on and on. And so, here are standards for outward living, a truth. Now, this is important because a lot of times, you know, we see these things and we go, oh, well, you know, but watch this. The Bible says he's written these on our heart. Okay. Now, we can go into the deepest, darkest jungles of the world, right? And when we do, we can pull up on the boat to a little tribe, right? We can get out and we can go and we can, you know, shake their hands and everything. And then we can look around and we can see their goat. And we can just start staring at that goat. Just staring at that goat. And I guarantee you, they don't know the language, but somebody's going to walk over there and go, why are you looking at my goat like that? You looking at my goat like you want to take it. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Amen. Anybody ever been looking at something you had and they're like, did you run? No. Why are they looking at me like that? You get all nervous, you know what I'm saying? Start winking at their wife. See what happened. And you don't even have to know the language. It's a universal language. You know it's going to happen. You know they're going to get you, right? If you have a child, and, you know, all of us who have children or whatever the case may be, we've all experienced this, where you get, you get your little nephew or your cousin, you throwing them up and playing with them and you swinging them and having a good time, and your child comes up and grabs your leg and starts talking like, and you're like, what? I'm just, let me hold. Oh, I'm going to pick you up. What? Stop. I'm going to pick you up next. Stop. You know? Because they don't want you to commit adultery on them. You're supposed to be with them. Are y'all with me? And so they get jealous. And they believe that you're committing some type of crime playing with their little cousin. It is something that is on the inside of us. Nobody wants anybody to take anything from us. Nobody likes that. Kids don't like that. Amen? There is something that is right here that is fundamental to our nature, that nobody has taught us that. Nobody sits there and teaches that child to be like that, to have that type of feeling. Nobody puts that in that child's heart, that if you go and you take that toy, if another child, I don't care how small they are, you try to take that rattle and see what they do. You know how that go. You're like, oh, Lord. What'd you do with my baby? No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, you know your baby cry like that. Anyway. Is this on tape? Is it? Oh, my bad. So even that little infant doesn't want you taking stuff from them. How would they know that? And this begs another question, is that we can't be born good. As the Bible says, we ain't born good. We're born in sin. Anybody ever had a child? You in the kitchen, just you and them, and they, and you're like, are you eating something? No. I'm like, are you eating something? You eating something? No. You're like, oh my gosh, I can't believe that. Did you take that cookie? It's just me and you. What's in your hand? Because I guarantee you, nobody's at home teaching their child how to lie. At one and two. But how does that child know? They're not running. They don't feel threatened. They're not running. They're just saying no. They're just lying. Look at your neighbor and say, I know they're cute. But, no. So he gives us the commandments. He formulates a base for living, for outward living, not to do these basic things. You know, the Bible says government comes from God. Government is a hierarchical structure that creates order. It is a creation of God. Amen? You ever seen kids get together, just little bitty kids run around? Ain't no order there. It's chaos. You never see. Order is against our nature. It's against our nature. We have to learn order. Go to a daycare and see what happens. They just, they everywhere. You're like, oh my gosh, how can you take this? It's like organized chaos. You just kind of herding them here, like herding cats. Just kind of herding them. Y'all ain't trying to hurt no cats, huh? Oh, we got some cat lovers, though. Watch this. So Galatians chapter 5, if you go to Galatians chapter 5 for me quickly, I want to I'll show you what Galatians chapter 5 says. So God has given us instructions about outward living, but he also gives us information about inward living. Amen? So again, we're talking about, we're using this, these examples to go against relativism and pluralism. That individuals who talk about, you know, my point is valid, my position is valid, and it's just as valid as this other position over here. I mean, we have a problem. It's chaos. Because if I believe that, you know, you going along, you feel justified in busting out my windows when you get mad, keying my car. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I go too far over there? Yeah. And well, they deserve that. They deserve that because they left me. They deserve that because they did this to me. They deserve that because I saw something on TV and made me mad. And so I'm burning businesses down. I'm riding in the street. And I'm justified. Ain't nothing happened to you. Why are you tearing up stuff? You still breaking the law. Are y'all with me? You are breaking the law. And so for us to get up and overlook that, for instance, you know, all the things that have happened recently, I guarantee you, just like they said, they're rewinding the film right now. And they're like, I know him, her, him. Oh, I know him and her. And they will prosecute them, and they are going to prosecute them. There was no justifiable reason for you to jump into somebody else's business. I don't care how mad you are. To burn down a business, to beat somebody up, to throw rocks at somebody who's sitting there eating on the side of the sidewalk. Because you mad? You don't even know that dude. See, that's what drives me crazy. If people go out and write, you don't even know that person. You have no idea who they are. You just heard something. You just following the crowd. And you justified and you yelling at folks like somebody did something to you. You know, you find that in the Bible, and this is not the first time something like this happened, but you find in the Bible the lady who committed adultery. And all these men drug her into the square, and they picked up these rocks. And they ready to kill her. And they got the rocks and they ready to stone her. And they pulled Jesus into it. And Jesus come walking up, man, y'all violent. What's wrong with y'all? I'm taking a little liberty, right? And so he's looking around, man. What? You know, what should we do? We caught her in adultery. Well, first of all, where the dude at? Right. Where is he? No, well, see, our law says if we catch one adult, you know, this, that, and other. He said, okay. He said, so the person without sin cast the first stone. And it says that he got down and started writing. Now, I'm sure he was writing. Tom was, nobody named Tom in here. Okay. So Tom was blah, blah, blah. And Mary was over here doing X, Y, and Z. Boy, you know, people started. They started tipping out. I think he must have been going in alphabetical order. He was probably like, ooh, he's coming down to the C's. Get out of here before he get to C. Go on, he look up, where am I at? But the custom was that for stoning, the custom was that the first person who could throw a stone was the one who had not committed that particular sin. So when you understand that, everybody in there had committed adultery. And they had to walk away. And that's what he's probably writing. Tom was with Mary. You know, Ralph was with such. Everybody, okay. I know he's coming. I'm gone. You know. And they got out of there. But that was the law. The people who had not committed that particular sin, yeah, you could start to stone it. And then everybody else could join in. But they couldn't stone the woman because there wasn't anybody who could start the show. Because they all committed adultery. Amen. People having that that pluralistic mindset or that relativistic mindset that I'm right. And I'm right irregardless of anybody else. I'm right. That's called stubborn. You know, we always say that. We just like that in my family. We just stubborn. Whew, you're not gonna last long in a relationship, I guarantee. Watch this, Galatians chapter 5. Let me show you this. And I'm just gonna read, I'm gonna read 18. I'll go to 18. Let me read this. He says, but if you are led by the Spirit and not under the law, now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, revelries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who continue to do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step or walk by the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. Wow. So he talks about inwardly. He gives us the positive and the negative of inward living, of having a standard. That's all I'm talking about tonight, is having a standard. In this world, you have to have a standard. There has to be a standard. There has to be a truth. There has to be a fundamental rule or guidelines, a litmus to live by. And if we call ourselves believers, that means we have to follow the edict of the Word of God. We cannot be like the world. The world can be wishy-washy. The world can be all over the place, but we can't. And I talk about this all the time, that for many people that are in churches, he's just Savior. They just have some fire insurance. That's all they have. They just, I won't go hell, you know, none of that kind of stuff. But when is he going to be Lord? If he is Lord, then you fall under his kingdom or his lordship. That means you follow his rules. Amen? And this is what Jesus is talking about. This is what Paul is talking about. This is what the Old Testament is talking about. All the way through is that there is a standard. That's why we have the rule book. It is an open book test. It's not hard. But when we don't open our books, and okay, amen. I felt a move on spirit. We got to open our books. We got to open the book, the Word, and we have to know it. Because if we don't know the Word, how do we know what he wants from us? Amen? Now here's this. Watch this. There's a lot of people, I mean, across the world watching this and in here. If, and I use this example all the time because I think it's so true, that if we went to school once a week, and I mean if we went consistently once a week, how long would it take you to learn to read? How long would it take you to learn to write? Going once a week, going twice a week, how long would it take you to learn how to do algebra? It would take forever. And many times, Christians apply that same, the same example, it's applied to Christians' lives. And so, yes, we'll come to church once a week, but in between, we do nothing. We don't pray, we don't read, we don't try to do better, we don't practice what we learned. You would never learn how to be the best believer you could be. Can I get amen? So think about as believers, we'll miss church, we'll miss this, we'll forget to pray, we'll forget to read. There are a lot of believers who never read the Bible. There are a lot of believers that they come on Mother's Day, Christmas, they child's play. There are many parents that I see that they'll drop their kid off, but they'll say, listen, I want my kid to grow up with a moral standard. What time y'all finish? I'll be back. Don't leave. It starts with you. You know what I mean? You're running out to come back, you know. I mean, it starts with the parent. If we do right, man, I just tell parents, man, you can leave your kid at home and you come. I mean, you know, if you go back, if you take back what you learn in church and exercise it at home, your kids will be awesome. Okay. Watch this. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're almost done. We're almost done. I have two things I want to show you. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Hope this is helping somebody. Any questions so far? Any questions so far? Any comments, questions? All right. Okay. Verse number 14. Now, and again, I want you to keep in your mind relativism and pluralism. Everybody thinking that their position is right, thinking that their truth is right, and everything they do, it's right. And nobody can tell them anything, or they believe, you know, their position is just as valid as somebody else's. And I'll just throw this out here. You know, and I like to connect this because a lot of times we're not really thinking about this. Do you know that, I'm gonna use kids as an example, all right, that our kids grow up with a relativistic mindset. Did something just run by? Y'all looking at me. You know, they think they're right. You can't tell them nothing. Now, I know these kids are great. You can tell them anything. But a lot of times, you grow up, you can't tell them anything. They're second-guessing you. And they, well, you don't understand. I understand. I have been your age. I know exactly what you're talking about. No, you don't. No, you don't. Well, you mean no, I don't. I've been there, done that. But they have that mindset, that pluralist mindset, or that relativistic mindset, saying that my position is valid. Yeah. I didn't obey that teacher because that teacher made me mad. So I didn't do my homework. You know you will fail. What? I can't believe they gave me a bad grade on that test. You do your work. What are you talking about? Well, the teacher made me mad. Wow. Watch this, 14. It says, for the body does not consist, and this is 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and I'm in verse number 14. It says, but it says, for the body does not consist of one member, but of many. The foot, if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body. That would not make it any less part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I don't belong to the body. That would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, we are all many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And on those parts of the body that we think are less honorable, we bestow greatest honor, or greater honor. And our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts do not require. but God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. Y'all see that? If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church, first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healings, helping and administrating and various tongues. All apostles, all prophets, all teachers, all do miracles, do all possess the gifts of healing, do all speak with tongues, do all interpret, but earnestly desire the higher gifts. And I will show you a more excellent way. And then he rolls into love. Amen? So at first it could seem chaotic. It could seem like a relativistic or pluralist mindset that he's talking about. It looks like relativism, but no, he comes back and says, no, we are fit together. We are one. We have unity among each other. We have a common core. We have a common foundation in Christ Jesus. And so here's the thing. No matter how different you are or I am, we all have the same foundation. Amen? And it's only when we believe we don't have the same foundation that we have problems. But if we don't learn that, if we're not taught that, if we're not taught order, amen? If we're not taught unity, it comes through the Word of God, through His Spirit, that all believers, we have the same Spirit inside of us. So we ought to what? Get along. Oh, man, that was three amens. We all get along. You shouldn't be mad if you come in and somebody in your seat. Somebody got your mic. You used to be hallelujah. Somebody parked in your parking spot. Remind me to label pastor on my parking spot. So I ain't mad, see me, you know. Y'all know who y'all are. Okay, 2 Timothy, and we're done. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Yeah, I know y'all never parked there. Huh? All right, I'm praying for y'all. All right, 2 Timothy chapter 3. We have to have an ultimate standard for living. Let me read quickly, and we're closing right here. Verse number 13. I'll start at 12. Anyways, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete and equipped for every good work. That the word of God is good for creating that standard in our life, for reinforcing that standard, for exposing that standard, for us helping us to learn from that standard. The word of God is right here through His Spirit. Will help us keep that standard and not fall into the mindset of relativism and pluralism, that our way or the highway. Amen? But that we can learn to submit to the truth, and that we have this moral compass called the truth, the Word of God, that helps us live a better life. Amen? Amen. Well, I hope this has helped you. And just know that, you know, as you get deeper into the Word, you know, God is going to continue to reveal more of His Word to you in your daily lives. Amen? Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen.